So, well, what I would like us to start off for today is I'm going to give you just a list of random words. Okay, you need to participate for this one again, please.
Okay.
So I'm just going to give you, just take any of these pieces of paper. Okay, for now. Just hold the grab on for a minute.
Thank you.
Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you 30 seconds to just read through it as many times as possible. Yes. That's all I'm going to tell you for the moment. Just read through it as many times as possible. For 30 seconds, go. All right, excellent. Now, can you please swap your piece of paper with somebody next to you, just in case it fits? Okay, and I would like you now to tell the other person how many of those words you remember. Okay, and they need to check, so do that for me, please.
In order?
No, it doesn't have to be in order, just how many words. Okay. Alphabetically, please.
Alphabetically. So I had play, spiritual,
yak,
or something like that.
Plane. I've already forgotten all of
them. Room, was that one of them?
I can't remember.
Cooperative, was that one of them?
Okay, fine.
Okay. Yeah, I'll stick with that. Okay, go
ahead. Okay, therapeutic. Not.
Okay, let's wrap it up. Okay, bring it to the table. Okay, so how many words did you remember?
I think I remembered four, and she remembered six. So.
Two words. Julie, how about it?
About five or six, right. I think. Yeah.
This time around,
six.
Six.
I'm not the same ones.
Yeah. That shows no progress.
The first time I
got
number one.
Oh, okay. I'm gonna get
you. Yeah,
from 1 to 6 is pretty good.
So what I would like you to do is grab another one. Okay. Should we put this one back? No, hold on to it. That's fine. Hold on to that one. And this time, I would like you to think of a story you're going to tell the other person. Using the words I'm thinking of right now. Yes, using the words on the
No, I didn't know what you meant.
No, just the new one. the new words.
Can we look at the words, or do we have to remember?
Yeah, remember them. So you've got 30 seconds to think of a story using those words that you can tell.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
That's fair. Thank you. Think of a story using those words. As many as you can. Doesn't have to be in order. Okay, time. So now you can please pair up. Yeah. And
Okay.
And please tell the story to the other person.
Okay.
So and tell me what they're on.
Jail for break the ice with a wrench.
I was at a friend's house.
So let's bring it to a how many did you get?
Five.
And how many did you get initially? In the first?
Four.
And in this case, how many did you remember? More, less?
Yeah, I got four at first, and now I got six. So
yeah.
And then you got six at first, and now you got eight, I think.
Yeah, but I did do a story the first time. We just forget it.
So, what do you think was the point of this activity? Okay, and what was I trying to show you through this?
Memory factor.
Memory, yeah. Okay, and did you feel more engaged?
With the story?
Yes. Okay. Because what I'm going to do at the end of this session, I'm going to ask you to tell us how many words you can remember from both lists, okay? Without looking at them again. Okay. So, if we talk about this, so we're talking about engagement basically today. And if you hear the word engagement, what are the things that you think of? Just what are the words that comes to mind?
Interaction.
Okay, what else? Engage, maybe.
Fun.
Yeah, what else?
Discussion.
Yeah.
Action.
Action, yeah. Anything else?
Group,
yeah. Participation, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay, anything else? So, that is all the kind of things that we need to kind of engage students. Is that, do you agree with that? Is there anything else you think you would need to kind of engage a student? Making it fun, making it interesting, participation, interaction, discussion. What else was there?
Fun interaction, debate.
Relevant, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Have you ever had a student that you weren't sure why they were there, they weren't sure why they were there,
We get a class in a restaurant, for example, like girls' room, and the topic is about, I'm going to be teaching with a happy, but it's not worth it.
And your case, what can you think of the worst possible student you've ever had?
Yeah.
Okay. Why was that?
Real Madrid like they sell all the merchandise, and he just sort of like sat there. How much like he tried to make it interesting, he just was like sort of like, yeah, really slowly and all. So it was like, however you tried to make it, he was just not having any of it.
So why was he there?
I think he was supposed to be like
How about if it's like private students, the ones that take the class that they want, but they don't really seem that interested? Why do you think that might be? Okay. The topic, the content.
That he already knows the content. It was comfortable with that. Some people are.
Okay, but it's too easy. Yeah. Anything from your side, Jay?
Maybe they're not paying for the car.
Yeah. So they don't have that investment.
Yeah, maybe the company is paying for the car and they're not really that interested. Perhaps quite a lot. Yeah.
Because if we talk about engagement, there are four basic things that we need to talk about. And what you've said, basically now, kind of slots in with the quadrant somewhere. Yeah. So let's take a look over here. There are three basic things related to engagement. Now, it can be divided into two bits, right? Mainly of things that we can observe or things that the students are experiencing internally. And as you can see, we've got academic, behavioral, cognitive, and affective. Now, what do you think this means? If we talk about academic engagement, what on earth might that mean?
my 13th school. Okay. It's not like a there's two schools like maybe 20 years give it the lecture them and sit down because
In terms of engaging activity, that might mean if you're in a school, there are certain rules, aren't there? Like, what kind of things does the school offer generally? Okay, well, if you think about the structure or the infrastructure or the place, what kind of things do the students need to engage with?
Classroom, other students?
Classroom, okay, yeah, they need to engage with the rules, the teacher.
Mm-hmm. I think it's more like very strongly teacher led, and they're not sort of sometimes encouraged to speak like naturally, as we try to encourage at Oxbridge, so they speak only when spoken to someone.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very good point. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they don't engage.
Yeah.
They just sit back.
Yeah.
Easier to sit back.
Okay, fair enough. Okay. Yeah, because they kind of lay down the law and that's how things are supposed to be, right?
Yeah, and you're used to learning in a way which is like you're told information, you memorize it, you reproduce it in an exam.
Yeah,
that's exactly. Okay. How about the next one then? How do you think students, if we talk about their behavior in class, how can you see if they're engaged or not engaged? Okay, yeah.
Body language in general.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't
tell. The way they participate and all that. Yeah.
Okay.
They're on their phones.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So in the way that they kind of, the behavior in class specifically, fair enough. How about if we talk about internal processes, things that they're going through, like let's focus on the affective side, the emotional thing. How do you think emotionally they can engage or interact in the class, based on what?
I think that's what we were talking about making things relatable to them. So if you talk about, for instance, law, and for someone who works in a restaurant, it might not be the best way to be effective, but if you talk about food or prices or something like that, there might be more of an engagement emotionally to their work.
I think that's a really good point because, for example, if you talk to somebody, do you like going to the theater? No. When did you last go to the theater? I've never been to the theater. So then all the target lines in that section, and what do? You just skip it because it's a theater? No. You then turn around and you start saying, well, yeah, exit stage right, and maybe you might use that in a different way in your situation.
Yeah.
To get away from it, right?
Can you try and turn around as you're saying, apply it to whatever they're interested in? And then they start sitting forward and going, I didn't know that. What does that mean? And then, so you learn using the. Because you've got to follow the script, because otherwise you just go skipping all the material, and it's like not the plan.
Mm-hmm. We'll get into that in a moment. We're going to put that in practice a little bit later. So keep that in mind.
Yeah.
So what you were saying, actually, oddly enough, with this little structure is actually the cognitive function. Over here, if you talk about effective, we're talking about personal.
We need to about family. And as long as you say, it's good girl, your brother is most of the time, so what's the name of the name of yours? So we can have that.
So when we focus on the effective thing, it has to do with that personal or relational kind of connection. How does that apply in the classroom? How can you sense if somebody is engaging regarding the other people in the class?
Oh, I don't know that. I was just going to have an example. Would the example be saying their name, even? Something as small as that, making that connection with the teacher and student thing. By saying their name, okay, just saying how is it someone say your name is
That personal connection. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. Because that specific thing focuses a lot on if you consider how that person feels in terms of the others as well. Like maybe you've got a class with a boss and a secretary, and I don't know if the dynamics are kind of affected by that.
Yeah.
In what way?
Yeah, sometimes you don't even know, and then you just feel it sometimes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They might not be as inclined to express their full opinion about whatever topic, and I don't know, if it's a topic about your boss,
Where did you last go on holiday? I never go on holiday.
On top ground.
if you have like people from the same company and they know each other well, but they're different levels, sometimes there's an awkward dynamic where like one kind of keeps trying to help the other, but sort of is annoying them by like not letting them say stuff or not.
Parent-child relationship almost, where the one is constantly kind of telling them the answers but not really giving them the opportunity to participate. Now, if we take one of these things that we've just said, how does that apply to how we do things at Oxbridge? So, if we consider that the academic side talks about how the students follow the system, how can we get them engaged with the system or the content or the material? We don't hear about the rules and regulations that we kind of enforce.
Quick question, something with that.
For example, okay.
So they always expect quick questions. They always know that that's the first thing that we'll do.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, it's not a rule, but it's something that I think helps structure the class and get them. I always call it like a warm up, like you warming them up. So.
Mm-hmm. It should be a rule. We shouldn't do a class without quick questions.
Yeah.
And I find the wrap-up questions as well, leading on from that, very helpful as well.
Yeah.
The general wrap-up at the end really helps to cement what we've covered in the class as well. So I think that's really effective and helps them to remember things which they might struggle on.
So they should know what to expect is something.
Yeah, I think so. Especially, when we rotate and so on as well, we kept all doing our quick questions and wrap-up. Then they know exactly what to expect.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go in straight away, you say, okay, we're going to start normal with quick questions, and they know straight away they get into the mindset of what to expect.
Okay, so how does that kind of translate in terms of the behavior then? If you can, how do we get them involved in terms of behavior?
I think that also provides a bit more of a structure for us because they can kind of not predict exactly what's going to happen, but obviously when you're going to a class, you like to be able to know, okay, this is how it's going to be ordered, and it shows that it's like there's a structure to how we're teaching. So it sort of gets the students to think, okay, this is going to be a beneficial use of my 1 hour or 2 hours, however long the class is, and I can get the most out of it.
Do you guys agree? Now, similarly, this is the aspect that we're going to focus a lot on, the cognitive aspect in terms of how do we make things relevant for students. We'll get back to that in a little while. And then the last one is just talking about the dynamics in terms of relationships. Yeah. Now, the folks at Edutopia, they've come up with the following tips and tricks. Now, tell me if you agree or disagree with any of these. Yeah. The first one is, it says they're connected to their lives and things they already know.
Yeah.
Give it context. Agree? Disagree?
Yeah.
Okay. Why?
Can you think about it? Make more language?
I think humans like to talk about themselves. It makes it easy thing.
Yeah, relevant things.
Yeah, especially people like to talk about themselves.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. No. I was just gonna like add on a little bit to that and just say that they say that the beginning of the class they'd be on holiday or something like that, then you can later on in the activity say, oh, okay, you've been on holiday to there, and connect it to the activity, and that just makes it a little bit more interesting because, as Judy said, they can then talk about themselves and then holiday a little bit more, you just opens them up.
Also, I think it like, helps with the balance of, you know, when someone's frustrated and they feel stupid, they don't really want to. Sometimes they retract and they don't want to learn. So if you actually are trying to have them the role reversed and they're teaching you, for instance, holiday, where'd you go? Oh, I've never been there. Tell me about it. It's more, there's the more that interaction where they don't even realize maybe that they're learning at the same time, but they feel more like empowered, I guess, to talk.
Because they're involved with what they're doing.
If they think they're going to use it in the future as well, they're more likely to like interact because I don't know, like if you're teaching some really abstract like philosophy or something, it's like, oh yeah,
So that's something that we'll have to talk about in a bit in terms of how we can say anything and then make it relevant. Yeah. So how about the suspense aspect? What do you think they meant with that?
I don't know.
To keep them engaged to the class if they're expecting something to happen later.
So they don't know exactly. Not now.
Also, I think to
like not tell them answers like straight away. So sometimes it lasted about a topic, and like for example, I think there was the bioterrorism one. Like some of the students had like no idea what bioterrorism was. You know, they knew what terrorism was, but not bioterrorism. And you know, to keep it kind of, you know, okay, so let's wait for the article to, you know, for you to be able to find out what it actually is, as opposed to telling them, oh, bioterrorism is this, you know.
Yeah, that's true.
So, you know, keeps the class kind of in a nice flow and just engaging, like you guys said.
What are some other ways that we can do that?
Using suspense or using?
Yeah, suspense specifically. Yeah.
Do you follow the program? Because somebody often wants to Google a text that you ask people as well.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Or maybe in some cases where you would, if you do a structure, like we mentioned last week, maybe just call out a random person at the end. Maybe not saying who you're going to ask, but kind of keep them on their toes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe showing them a picture, and they have to kind of interpret what the topic is going to be about, or what they think the content is going to be about.
Could you use suspense also for what we talked about last week, for different ways of correcting? So sometimes you get a student and they're just used to you going, oh, maybe you should, you know, but then you start doing like, that's all right?
Yeah, the facial expression, right?
The facial expression, yeah. That's
my favorite.
I've done that class.
He's going to get right
now. I can trademark it.
It's copyrighted.
Yeah.
So I think strike balancing between suspense and in actually having a structure that you just mentioned before as well. So how do we keep those things in balance? Because like 5 minutes ago, you all say, oh yes, that's very important. Quick question, wrap up. So, and that's a specific structure. Doesn't that break down the suspense in some way?
I think in minor ways you can do suspense. That's why when I first saw suspense, I was like, why would you, like, instead of doing good questions, say we're a jumping jack, hey. No, it's like more suspense than small things, right? Like, the way that you correct, or maybe if you're reading a passage, stop them if you don't usually stop them, you know, or just change up your structure instead of changing up the structure in general, maybe the way you teach.
Keep it fresh, essentially, is what you're saying.
Yeah,
like,
that's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Kind of mixing things up. How about the next one? It says make it student directed and appeal to their emotional side. That's kind of something we're all talking about eventually now, isn't it? Like, it seems like we're talking about that the whole time, essentially.
Yeah.
That we need to engage them on an emotional level. Yeah. So why don't we put that to the test? Yeah. What I would like you to do, do any of you need a pen? Yeah.
Yeah.
So please take two or three of these and just pass them around. Yeah, two or three.
Oh, I've got
blank. Yeah,
all blank. Oh,
that's why you're going to be one. And what you need to do for me is I would like you to create zany, lonely heart cards. Zany, like crazy situations. Create crazy people.
Okay.
Funny, interesting. Oh, that's a different decision. Yes. Yeah, so think of and use this criteria. You don't have to use all of them. Okay. There we go, sorry. So two or three, we're going to throw them in the bag and we're going to draw them at random.
What's this like, the app for what you're looking for?
Just create a basic profile of the person.
Oh, okay.
Yeah? A student, essentially. Alright. Not going to change your life, okay? So
How many do we do?
As many as possible.
Right, that's fancy, everybody. So if you can just throw that in for me in the little bag. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to mix these up. And I'd like you to take two. Okay, two or three. And I would like you to write down a number between 1 and 45 on each one of them in the back.
Random number.
Just a random number between 1 and 45, it doesn't matter. Okay?
You take two.
Just take two or three, yeah. Have you written down the number between 1 and 45 on the back?
Yeah. Okay.
You can unpass to the person on your right.
Someone wrote down that same name I did.
I'm like, what?
Are you sure that's not your piece of paper?
I got that.
Oh, you
pass
them along?
Okay,
pass
them away? No, just pass them to the right.
Pass them to the right.
Yeah. Does it matter if you get the one you actually need? No, there doesn't. So just make sure you don't have the same ones you've had before. Okay, so make sure that you have two that's not yours.
No, I have mine. I have mine.
Okay, then swap.
I have one that's mine.
Okay. Are we all sorted? Right. Now, the thing is, the reason why I asked you to write down a number is because that relates to a specific target language topic that you would teach. Okay. So I would like you to take a look then at what you're going to, at the specific number. Okay, and then how you would engage that student on that specific topic regarding, like, what you see on the paper. Okay. So whatever your number is. Don't change the number now.
I just can't remember.
Photography
aspect,
yeah.
Is
it
a
hobby?
That's her
hobby, yeah. alive. So let's see what we have. Okay, why don't you take things away?
Okay.
So tell us who the person is and then how you would like to teach just one of them. Okay, just focus on one of them.
Okay, sure. Yeah. So I've got Jack. Yeah. He's a male. He's 26 year old. He's a 26 year old. Yeah. He's a football. Is that his? I'm not sure. Okay, that's his hobby. Okay, he's a waiter, but he likes football, going to the theater, and paddle. Okay, and I have to teach him about catering.
Okay.
So actually, that's pretty good because he's a waiter.
Yeah.
So. So is this like topic activities we're talking about, or
anything? It could be a topic can be about that. That's not the objective here.
Okay.
Yeah. The objective here is to see how you get involved. So how would you structure it if it's about catering?
Sure. Well, I guess I don't know. You could start with like some vocab, you know. Teach them how to, I don't know, maybe some like role plays as well about, I don't know, like food and, I don't know, maybe you could even grab the menu from their restaurant and just like play some role plays with them or something. You know,
yeah. How about the other one? What's the other one you thought?
The other one, this one, okay, it's a retired person who wants to be understood when he or she goes to London for a visit.
Okay, very good.
Okay, and I've got to teach him about cosmetics.
So. Okay, so how would you go about that?
Okay, well, I don't know, London is like the place to be for fashion and for like this kind of thing. Well, maybe like cosmetics, like you can find them anywhere really, but obviously in London it's quite a big scene about this kind of thing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So
with the second one, I would like you all to jump in as well. Like, if you've got any ideas, please throw that. The second one, let's see.
I think it's gender, like, stereotypical, but is it a man or
woman? It says he or she, so.
He or she.
Okay, it's a man.
Ah.
Or transgender.
It could be a gay man, you know, like, and then mixing people.
I like cosmetics, by the way. And I'm not gay.
Cosmetics,
just makeup we're talking about, or cosmetics, anything?
Cosmetics. Again, I just, the objective here is not the vocab, the idea is to see how you would engage with what you've got.
Okay. Yeah. So maybe just that in general, to introduce the lens in this fashion, cosmetics, and then to introduce the book out there.
Mm-hmm.
About the shops, you talk about different shops.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking as well, yeah.
Like you think about
Sephora.
I'm not about like a trans tool, like I'm subject, and then you get cosmetic that.
Yeah. It could talk about like I don't know if it's for like this could work I think for a guy or a girl, you know, like for a male or a female. You could talk about like shops like Lush or Body Shop as well, because I mean I think nowadays guys like to take care of themselves as well. And I buy like creams as well for my hands. But you could maybe like talk a little bit about that, like different products, different different ingredients that you could use in cosmetics that are good for certain things.
I've got one. They're retired, so they're probably older. I don't know.
Exactly. Yeah, they're retired. So
maybe you can talk about the evolution of cosmetics. Like, talk about when they're younger, what they were using to wash their face, things like that, and then talk about how we have different cosmetics today. So it would maybe be more engaged that way. Like, oh, I remember when we used to just have soap, and now you guys have everything.
Now you've got this
other one.
I think you can try another one.
what do you have in your office?
I have, in the hotel industry, wants material focused only on their area only and firefighting. So that's kind of easy. You can talk about like kind of the protocol for fire safety and like thing management in their hotel. And kind of talk about it more generally, but make like firefighting and vocabulary in general, but make it then narrow it down and make it specific to their hotel and what kind of procedures and have they had any experiences with fire drills and that.
Yeah. Good. And the other one that you had?
Wilfred McCoy, 59, life coach, light scuba diving, and transportation. That's harder. I think maybe because he's a life coach, you can kind of probably more receptive to like different ideas, maybe like things that his clients are interested in or problems they have and stuff. So you could relate transportation that way, maybe ask him to imagine he's sort of life coaching someone in the transportation industry or with problems with transportation.
Yeah, definitely the floor. What would you guys do?
Maybe scuba diving, I would try maybe
transport.
Scuba diving, that's one of his hobbies, right? So obviously there's transportation involved in that, and talking about different ways of transportation, like if you have scuba diving, obviously you're traveling quite a bit for that, so maybe trying to use that as a connection.
Mm-hmm. Vince, what did you have on your list?
I don't really get what the, what's the link between what's on written here and then what I've got to teach them?
So this is the number 45.
45?
Is imaginary people. You have to teach them about imaginary people. You got lucky on that.
I would start by saying, imagine. Well, I've got Gladys Smith, who is non-binary, 25, graphic designer, and likes water skiing. So the first thing I would say to Gladys is, Gladys, what does non-binary mean? Because I don't know. What does non-binary mean?
It means you don't identify as non-binary.
Okay, so
I'm trying to shake you.
So that's fine. That's good. So I would say, what are people who you know in the world of cinema who are not real people? And then I would start a discussion around cinema and fantasy and her experiences in the world of storytelling.
Great, great. And the other one? That's pretty good, yeah.
Andrew Smith, this is number 7.
7, Jobs.
Jobs. Well, Andrew Smith is male, he's 30, he's a student, he's interested in cleaning, I think. I would say Andrew Smith, you're clearly lying. There's no student interested in cleaning. So I would say, well, okay, what are you going to do then with your degree in cleaning and plumbing? So then start to explore what his interests were in, you know, where he saw himself. I would say, what jobs have you done? What's the first job you had? Where do you see yourself in 5 years? And show me some of your photographs.
Anything else on the table?
That was pretty good. Yeah. I would say, like, where would you see yourself in the future of whatever, you know, with these hobbies and how you can make
some money? Yeah.
How about you?
For this one? Yeah. For mine?
For yours.
Oh, for mine,
yeah.
Okay. So I have Joe DiMaggio, who's male and he's 90, a baseball player.
90 or 90?
90, 90 year old.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's going to be interesting path. Worth cooking and I think stem collecting and the, it was weather. Yeah, weather. So I was thinking just to talk about, well, these baseball players and just sports. We could talk about the different ways that weather affects when you play sports, baseball, usually about that. So maybe talk about when it's snowing, what kind of things they would need to do to prepare. Could they play outside, that sort of thing. It's raining, it's sunny.
The other one?
Translator wants to know how to make conversation. 17 is a food pyramid. So I was thinking maybe just, I mean, conversation, we could just talk about food in general, maybe talk about the basics of understanding the different ways that people order food, talking about restaurants, and then moving into talking about the food hierarchy and how foods groups can classify.
Okay. Anything else from the table?
You could probably like talk about going to market.
Markets
play a big part in some cultures in some countries, so that could like feed into like traveling and how to talk about.
Right, translating to the different ways that you would market.
The food driver in different countries or how to buy. Mm-hmm. What else? What did you have in yours?
I had Carrie Catfish. She's female, 35 years old, a teacher, and enjoys playing with her cat. and mine relates to personality traits, number 30. So I was thinking maybe talking about the difference between animal and human personality traits, if there is a difference. And in particular, if you've noticed any between cats and dogs.
So yeah, but I'm willing to take advice on how I would be able to teach her.
But yeah, I thought that might be a good start, like comparing different
perspectives.
You could ask her what she does when
she's not playing
with cats.
Thinking about.
<Yeah. laughs>
And the other one?
So Sylvia, she's female, 42 years old, IT technician, and enjoys video games. And I had newspapers, number 5 with her. So I was thinking, maybe talking about her opinion on technology news. So maybe thinking about like, are the people who are interested in video games and IT and computers, are they catered for in newspapers? What are the quality like? Is there a broad range? Do they talk about relevant topics? In those things. If she had to invent one, what would she include in that? Something like that.
Any ideas from you?
You're talking about like the media and how it associates video games with life.
That's a good one. Yeah.
Talk about as well, like different conventions and things like that, or like events that people, you know, like cosplay or whatever. You know what I mean, like.
I have Luciana, 35, who's a homestay mom, who likes cooking while I'm reading and the job application. So that would be interesting because she probably doesn't know that much about it. So we could go through how you would apply for a job, how she would feel applying for a job, maybe for the first time in her life. Also, you could talk about the advantages of like recruiting from different backgrounds, what kind of transferable skills she would bring.
I think what one girl said though, because I mean, like, she has no interest in
We were talking hypothetically, but if she has no interest in ever, if she's like, well, why would I need any of this language because I'm never going to have to apply for a job.
Or maybe related to her family or friends, then you might do.
Yeah. Well, then, if she was like that, I would say, what about if you wanted to recruit someone? With all the things, what kind of applications would you
do? Put her out, right?
That's why. Oh, yeah. Could have her like apply for her own job.
Yeah. What if she doesn't? She doesn't get it.
<You're fired.
laughs> And the other one?
Is Michelangelo Angelolo, male, 35, a dentist, and enjoys clock collecting. I have to talk to him about stationery. So I would probably talk about the impulse to collect and why people do it. People collect. Maybe you talk about like competitions of items and that way again.
But maybe, well, then we go with it like hoarding?
Oh, yeah.
That's a good one. That's
extreme.
Yeah, OCD problems and stuff like that. Yeah,
that's an intense emotional reaction.
Maybe you'll be able to like solve that problem.
How about in this corner?
I have Billy Duncan, I think, from it.
Yeah.
He's a worker and he likes to be in the environment. And remember, I have 38, so I'm
38?
No, Elkhart, sorry. So, yeah, well, I was talking about like, how to build. What materials do you need to get out of that? That's what he does.
And the other one?
The one is Marianne Ferrer, and she's a knight, a teacher, and she likes to draw cats and play with them. And I have
to
and it was a newspaper, so I thought about how she could use the newspaper for our school. So,
Last but not least.
Okay, I have Sami Tatsu. He's 33 and he's a TV host. He talks about English TV woman. She likes hunting and I have two vehicles. So as he's a TV host, I would ask him about programs about cars and what does he know about them, and also how to travel back and what vehicle to use if you want to be, for example. That would get him engaged. And then I've got Ethel. She's a female, 85, retired. She likes riding roller coasters while eating, carrying jelly. That's really
rad.
While carrying jelly. And I have to relate it to jobs, so I would probably ask if she would like to work in a theme park, for example, and she would like to work there. Carrying jelly. She's also retired, so she probably has a lot of experience already, so asking about her experience already, or her family, what job she knows already.
Now, before we kind of wrap things up, what I would like you to do first is pair up again and tell your story. See if you can remember the story you told at the beginning.
I remember there was several that was
You live in Alexandria as
well.
Yes,
fine. All right, everybody, let's bring it back.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so folks, we will wrap this up in a moment, yeah? So let's just see, how many of these words do you actually remember the second, like this time around? I remember like 4 or 5 or something like that. And from the first list? Wow.
For the first
time. I didn't really even think about the list. Like, I didn't remember the story and that was it. So my story,
one list.
Yeah.
5 words from the second list. So
from the second list, because you were engaged with material.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. I can remember the first list at all.
Yeah.
It's probably not too good, but. So my question ultimately is then, what are you going to take away from this discussion from today? How will this be useful for the future? What can we think of?
You need to find that way of sort of like replicating that in which like students engage with it so it has some sort of like personal connection rather than being learning a little word.
Mm. Yeah, rather than memorizing, actually making like connections with the words, and you know, it's just easier to remember if you create the story or if you, I don't know, if you can relate to the words or
Also getting some information about students, because sometimes you just get there and you start your class without knowing anything about the students, so maybe ask them questions like, what do you do in this company, or what do you like, so you can make
I think establishing that personal rapport early on, so goes your Albert said, like, if you can like talk to them a bit more, especially if you meet them for the first time, you can get an idea of what they're interested in, and then make the next few lessons you have with them afterwards that much more engaging and relevant.
Maybe that's something to look at in the future in terms of how we can get to know them. Well, I think that's all for today, folks. Yeah.
Cool.
So thank you for your time and the energy and the investment. That was really good. Thank you. Back to you.